We started with Roger in the morning here, and I will now end for today. A little bit spin-off, a little bit more detailed into one very interesting topic that we have both in marine but also in other areas. What is the fuel for the future? And I put here the headline that is gas the fuel for sustainable shipping? And I will try then to answer that during this presentation, so then see where we will end today. But I start here with also the statement we have from Wärtsilä there that to reach this 2030 target set by IMO, we see then that the combustion engine and LNG as a fuel, that will take you to the 2030 target. And then what is that based on? But first of all, we need to look into this emission part. When we talk about local emissions, we have this, that is mainly then NOx, SOx particles, and that is then, of course, very local for the human health and also, in a way, for the nature. But then maybe the more important topic when we go into this climate change, global warming, then we have these greenhouse gas emissions coming in from CO2 and methane, and of course, that is global. So it does not matter what you do locally, in a way what you then let out emissions in the globe as average, that is what matter. And even if now shipping industry is doing good, but of course we also need to contribute here. So then look into this, our statement about LNG to 2030. If we look into local emissions, you can then see without after treatment compared to running with diesel, then you see a dramatic change in these NOx, SOx and particulates. So locally, very good there. If we then look into this global warming aspect, we can then, and here we now use this, what is worldwide use as standard, you can have this global warming potential. We now then include, let's say, that also the methane slip calculated into a CO2 equivalent. So we can then see that we get a good improvement also using LNG. But then also I added to the left here, let's say this, another graph about the global temperature change potential, because for methane also, the lifetime of methane is only 12 years. So that means then that compared to CO2, that with methane, we can, if we then decrease that, let's say that you can have a very dramatic then improvement as the lifetime is only 12 years. So of course, here we can then still, of course, work with the CO2 and the methane from gas engines. Also, I'm that old, so I've been part of some part of gas and development within Wärtsilä for almost 30 years. And now in this graph you can then see the let's say, reduction of this methane slip from gas, Limburg gas engines, and that is then calculated into this, let's say, that greenhouse gas index. Of course, also CO2 comes from that fuel used, and of course, improving efficiency, you get a lower greenhouse gas index. But of course, that is history. It does not tell for the future. But of course, we know that this is not the end. We will still continue developing the engines, and also, but there are also other aspects. So, for example, on the engine technology, on small cars, you have this HCCR combustion. In an easy way, you could say it's pre-mixed air and fuel that you just have self-ignition of with the high temperatures. And that is especially then reducing the also methane slip on part load, improves efficiency on part load. So that, of course, a take that comes. But also, you can impact that with the fuel strategy or with this system integration hybrid. Should you then put this HCCR combustion for improved part load, or should you have then a hybrid running part load then with a battery, and then you run the engine always in optimal, let's say that high load conditions. Also said, we can impact it by the fuel strategy. Also, what is discussed a lot is then, for example, hydrogen. And you can then mix hydrogen into also LNG. You don't need to go 100 or zero. You can have this mixing, blending. But then, for example, putting then hydrogen into LNG, you get the faster combustion. That makes also then the load acceptance is more challenging. But then you can also then impact from this hybrid installation. If you then use that, let's say that the battery also for taking these, let's say that load peaks, so you get a more stable, let's say that output on the engine. And by that, you can then very easily also mix hydrogen into LNG. So what still I think Roger mentioned about this, we have here in Sweden, Luleå, we have this hybrid tug. Also we have for a fishing vessel, Norwegian Gannet, that I think now quite nearby here in Hirtshals at the moment. That's also hybrid installation. But to me the message is then that when you go into this hybrid, if of course it gets very also complex, have a lot of possibilities. So that then would be then to, you need to do this simulation, because in a way you would like then to have the best possible CapEx and also OPEX there. And of course you have different applications, you have different operating profiles. So that is then why also we have our own simulation tool that you can optimize that for your purpose. So then a little bit to summarize this to 2030, let's say that it's not just all about, let's say, engines or fuels, combustion. You need to look into all parts of the optimized voyages, vessel energy need, that you have many ways there also, power distribution, better come with hybrid, but of course then also efficient energy generation. That means then that when you run, you should run with high efficiency in that way, and of course the fuel part here. So I still see that the technology is there already today, but of course the challenge is that you will most probably have a price tag to reduce the CO2 emissions. And that means then that our task is then together to see then that how should we optimize this, looking into all these bits and pieces, to also get the most, let's say, that economical feasible solution. So that's where I think we're repeating the word together many times today. Then also, as we have stated then, that to reach the 2050 targets, said by IMO, you can still do it with a combustion engine, but then you need to go into the fuel mixture. Otherwise, you cannot reach that, and that, of course, creates challenges in that way. Our statement then, we see then that the biosynthetic LNG would be the best fit for that, and then I have some logic behind that. So, of course, the future fuels, you have a lot of different alternatives. David, I think here also, of course, you have Stena there with methanol. You have these biofuels, also ammonia is one that are discussed quite a lot. And of course then LNG or LPG in that respect. And of course there are others that are not listed here. So what is then the future fuels? Still if I look into the combustion or the engine, I claim that the engine itself will not be the big problem. We have different combustion concepts, like the dual fuel, lean burn dual fuel, we have a lean burn spark ignited gas engine, and then we have the diesel or also high pressure gas engine with a diesel process. So our job is then to, let's say that if you go into LNG, biosynthetic LNG, LPG, also then mixing hydrogen into LNG, for example, spark ignited gas is maybe the most suitable for that. If you go into methanol, ammonia, that's then the diesel or the, let's say, the high pressure gas or diesel injection there that is the most suitable, might be. And of course, then I call the dual fuel, might have still the best flexibility, because if you go into blending, you can then inject gas, LNG, bio-LNG, whatever, during the, let's say, gas admission. But then in the high-pressure side, you can then inject, for example, then hydrogen or some other mix in that way. So that might be and then still be the one with the best flexibility. But still important here is that that depends also where you do the mixing. Do you mix it in the bunkering or do you mix it on board if you have different fuels? So that's why I still take the statement then that I don't see that the combustion will be the, let's say, bottleneck, but we need to look into the, let's say, the fuel system on board or in the bunkering. And of course, then we come back to this, that whatever fuel you use, it needs to be economical feasible. So I think there lies the, let's say, that is the biggest challenge. Also, we are into these fuels then that to take it on one ship and reach the, for example, 70% reduction, that's not a problem. The problem when you go into this that you need to have it for the whole, let's say, that shipping industry, that means then that the fuel availability versus the demand, that will be the challenge. And of course, that also will, let's say, that influence the fuel prices. If you don't have availability and demand in balance, usually it's a higher fuel price. So of course, here we predict about the future, but I said, I don't think you will get this for free. So in a way to minimize the risk, it is good today to invest in an engine with high efficiency, because by that, you can then prepare for the future, what happens then with fuel prices. And I said, we don't need as engineer look into 700. You can maybe start then with adding 10% hydrogen, 20% hydrogen, and then take it stepwise to get this reduction to 2030 and then to 2050. Here is also, I think this is in Norway, we have this, let's say that the bio-LNG plant, and that is of course one possibility. And I think here I said that the important here is maybe where you do the mixing. And let's say then that being a vessel owner operator, in a way the best would be that you mix this in the pipeline or in the bunkering station, for example, with LNG, because then you can utilize your fuel system that you have on board. You don't need to adopt that. So that, of course, is one crucial part. Also, of course, if we look into this global warming, then we need to look into the whole, let's say, chain, what happens there when you produce fuel, say it's the well to propeller. And here in this example, you have this bio-LNG, but of course also we go into these renewables, as you know, on the land base, you have solar and wind, and of course then the best would be that you can then, by having excess solar wind, you are then able to produce hydrogen or synthetic LNG. But still remember, that is not either free of charge, even if you have excess of solar and wind. So that means still that we see then that investing in LNG, and then if you have future bio-LNG, synthetic LNG, that would be in a way the best solution, because you can still utilize the technology, the fuel system that you have on board. So of course, in the end, the target is that we get rid of these fossil fuels. Also, even if you are here in Donso, it's a beautiful, beautiful village here. As I come from Vasa in Finland, I needed to do some also promotion for Vasa in Finland. It's maybe not the biggest city or harbor. But here also now we have a new this ferry Vasa line between, will come between Vasa and Umeå. It's a hybrid using a dual fuel engine with batteries. And also in Vasa we have the bi-LNG, so currently buses are using that. But also then predicted that you can do that blending on this Vasa line. And by that you can reach this 70% target that you have on the, let's say, a single ship also here with a new ferry. Still a little bit also for this fuel prices, always happened that the exactly the same is happening on the energy business. I think Roger mentioned it also there. Because coming with solar wind, you need to have flexible base load, you need to have peaking. And that you can do with combustion engines. Today they are running on LNG, but of course also there is that their target to go for renewable fuels. So the same demand for fuel that also might come on the shipping industry will happen also on other areas. So again here, we will not have a fuel that is enough for everybody. So that's what I wanted to highlight here, that on a single ship, that's not an issue, but then there is a target of 50% by 2050 on, let's say, that all ships anyway. And here also it's important that we have this legislation, because when you need to invest in the future, you need also to have the, let's say, that fair business in that way. So what are the mechanisms by rules, incentives that you are then able that to invest what you need to in the future to reach the targets? And I said, one solution will not take us to the target. Then here some, let's say, that just takeaways. Of course, 2030 comes very fast here. So we need to use the energy sources, the fuels that we have today. But of course, fuel flexibility is important. High efficiency is important. So to invest in engines having high efficiency, that's a good investment. But then I said that you need a lot of fuel availability. So still the fuel availability and logistics, that will be one bottleneck, think about how long it takes for LNG. And that means then that you would need to invest there now on the fuel logistics to be able to reach the targets. And that's a heavy investment. So that is one of the challenges. So here we can see then based on this that still see that LNG is the best way, and then transition from fossil LNG to biosynthetic LNG from this also fuel available point of view. So to end here, I have this question that is gas the fuel for sustainable shipping? I claim yes. And also I see then the combustion engine or engine is enabler for that due to this efficient energy generation, and also you have this fuel flexibility and upgradability that you can then upgrade the engine according to need or change the fuel there.